Welcome to Faith and Freedom. For the next few minutes, we hope to inform, inspire, and encourage you as we discuss the legal victories and challenges to your fundamental freedoms and religious liberties. Faith and Freedom comes to you from Liberty Council, a civil liberties education and legal defense organization. Join us now as Matt Staver, the President and General Counsel of Liberty Council, explains the latest legal issues all across this country in the courtrooms of America. Liberty Council is winning the battle for your constitutional freedoms.
Liberty Council files a supplemental brief in the Obamacare case and a stunning admission from the United States Department of Justice. I am Matt Staver, founder and chairman of Liberty Council and dean of Liberty University School of Law. Joining me is Sean Akers, the dean of the Helms School of Government at Liberty University. And Sean, just before Memorial Day, the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals, where I argued this case on May the 10th, asked that all the parties, which include Liberty University and our private clients, the Commonwealth of Virginia, and the United States Department of Justice, file a supplemental brief with the court asking the question or addressing the question of whether the so-called Federal Anti-Injunction Act applies to this case. And if so, does it bar this court from hearing jurisdiction? And the Anti-Injunction Act is a law that's been passed for many, many years that requires in taxes that you have to pay your tax first in most cases and then ask for a refund, and when you don't like the refund, you sue over the refund. So this would mean if it applied, the federal court could not reach the merits of the case until sometime after 2014 when the so-called penalty slash tax, as they want to term it, is ultimately due. And that was a significant turn of events. We ultimately ended up having to file a supplemental brief working through the Memorial Day weekend and then filed it with the Federal Court of Appeals.
You know, Matt, that's an amazing admission. As a tactical matter, I'm not sure what they're shooting at, but this is definitely one of those. This crazy case has taken more turns already since the time that policy was drafted. It seems like people are kind of playing fast and loose with the whole scheme, and this is just one more of those turns in this case.
Well, you know, clearly when the court asked that question, does the Anti-Injunction Act apply? If it is yes, then that means that our lawsuit can't move forward, that we'd have to wait until 2014, have the mandate penalty imposed, pay that penalty, and then ask for a refund and then file suit. So this thing would drag on well past 2014 because we'd have to start the case all over again. That's the significance of the question that they asked. But we filed a response. And the Commonwealth of Virginia, in its case, filed a response. And the United States government filed a response. I'll talk about our response in just a few moments. But the interesting thing is that the United States government originally in the lower courts raised as one of its defenses to the lawsuits, not only in ours but in every other case, that the Anti-Injunction Act applied. And therefore, the federal courts don't have jurisdiction until such time as we pay the penalty or the tax as they were trying to construe it. Now, however, the United States Department of Justice filed a response on the same day we filed our brief saying that the Anti-Injunction Act, in their view, does not apply and that the statute language itself was drafted in a way that allows pre-enforcement lawsuit challenges. So you don't have to wait until the mandate is due. You can actually file suit now. So all three, the government of the United States, of course, Liberty University and our clients, and then also the Commonwealth of Virginia, of course, we all three agree it does not apply. But the most significant thing is that the United States government itself actually says that the congressional intent is to allow this pre-enforcement challenge. So they said this court can reach the merits.
You know, and you hadn't said that earlier. I jumped the gun a little bit. But that having been an admission of the United States in this case is staggering to me because you would think that they would want to postpone this as long as possible. But in this case, it looks like, you know, God has had favor and we'll reach the merits on it.
Well, you know, the thing about it is when Congress passed this law, Congress said that it was passing this law under the purported authority of the Commerce Clause, not the Taxing and Spending
That's
Clause.
Right.
Then when it got into litigation, the Department of Justice began to defend it on the basis that, oh, it's not Commerce Clause, it's the Taxing and Spending Clause, and that this mandate is not a penalty, even though that's what the statute says it is.
Right.
It's an actual tax, like an income tax or like an excise tax. and therefore it's permissible under that particular power. And Congress has more power under the Taxing and Spending Clause. But politically, there's a big difference between passing something through the Congress and getting the people to accept something regulating commerce as opposed to a new tax increase. And obviously, they chose not to put it under the Taxing and Spending Clause. Why? Because they did not have the political clout to sell this as a tax on the people. Because remember what happened was Senator Brown in Massachusetts ultimately replaced the late Ted Kennedy, and that messed up the Democrats' 60 majority people in the Senate, which could stop or override a filibuster of the Republicans. So that happened before this law was passed. Therefore, if they were to put it out as a tax, there would have been a filibuster and they couldn't go any further since they lost that 60 number majority. So they couldn't politically pass it as a tax. They had to pass it as something other than a tax. Therefore, it was considered a penalty, not a tax. Big difference from a constitutional standpoint. If it were a tax, then the Anti-Injunction Act, in fact, would apply. And you'd have to file a refund after paying the penalty, after paying the tax, and then ask for a lawsuit after that. Except if there's a, there are some minor exceptions to that, which I think even would apply in this case. So the government started off arguing that it was a tax and that the Anti-Injunction Act applied. None of the federal district courts bought that. They all rejected that argument that it's not a tax and that the Anti-Injunction Act doesn't apply. And then, of course, some of the federal courts, when they looked at the Commerce Clause, some of them said it's constitutional under the Commerce Clause. Some of them said it's unconstitutional under the Commerce Clause. Those cases are now percolating up on appeal. On appeal, the federal government abandoned its defense of the Anti-Injunction Act in every single case, abandoned it, did not raise it. So when this Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals asked the question, it came out of the blue. Every court had rejected that argument. The United States government had rejected that own that specific defense, didn't raise it in our case or any other case. But it looked like the court was wanting to revisit it. But now we came back and said it doesn't apply. We give reasons why it doesn't apply. But most significantly, the federal government has now come back and said, you know, we raised that as a defense in the lower court. Upon further consideration, we really believe it doesn't apply. And they didn't address the law so much as to why it doesn't apply as we did. They addressed the statute itself, and they said Congress intended it not to apply. So this is even better for us because if they were addressing the law only, the court could say, well, we're just as in good a position to address the law, and we disagree with your interpretation of the law.
Right.
But this is now the federal government speaking specifically to a federal statute. So they are interpreting their own statute. That gets a lot of deference at the court because even the court may disagree with the way the federal government interprets the statute. This is the federal government interpreting its own statute. And as such, they say statutorily within the statute itself, Congress intended this not to apply. Congress intended for these pre-enforcement suits to go forward.
You know, one of the most fascinating things about this statute and the litigation that's followed, Matt, is when you push through such a large, complicated bill that quickly, you simply haven't had the time to think through all the unintended consequences. It's just too big and too much. And you can see that both at the legislative stage and now at the judicial stage, the government has constantly had to go back and revise its approach because they didn't think of that and they didn't think of this. This is an exciting time to be a part of and to be supporting Liberty Counsel. You were involved leading the charge on a case that goes literally right to presidential politics. They put themselves in a horrible situation of either having to admit a tax increase and deal with that with the legislature or give in and admit that their argument was weak in the first place, and it's a penalty. So it put you in an incredible position. It's staggering to think, though, that Liberty Counsel is literally affecting both this case, one of the most important cases to reach the courts in you know probably this decade, and presidential politics as well.
Well, the interesting thing is we've not changed our arguments from day one, and the federal government has changed its arguments all the time. I've never quite been in a case like this where the federal government has constantly shifted its argument. And when they do that, you realize they don't really have a good basis
That's
to argue
right.
on. So if they persecute you in one constitutional text, then flee to another.
Yeah.
That's what they're doing. And so that really underscores the problem with this particular case. Tomorrow we'll talk a little bit more about this. Also talk about 350 Indian tribes that filed an amicus brief. You'll find out something very interesting about what's in this bill that no one knew. I didn't even know it until a few days ago. Give us a call at Liberty Council. Ask for the Patriots Handbook on American Liberty. Go to lc.org.
You have been listening to Matt Staver of Liberty Council. Our hope is to encourage and inspire you to stand up for your faith, family, and freedoms. We can accomplish a lot when we work together. Get informed and get involved today. Sign up for our free monthly newsletter, The Liberator. We will send it out to you free of charge. Stay informed with our Liberty Alert email update. Just click on the website at www.lc.org or call us at 1-800-671-1776. Tune in next time to learn more about your rights right here on Faith and Freedom.